Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight as you brought your children to bless them, enrich them. We pray that that which is lacking in our faith, perfect it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As we look up unto you, our Savior, our Master, our perfect example, the infallible God, pull us up to where we ought to be.
Amen.
Shape us and sharpen us in this way so that we can be who you want us to be in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Open our eyes once again tonight.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Tonight, we're looking at the message, looking on to the author and finisher of our faith. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. As we have been looking at this series, we have already looked at Jesus and Abel, and we have seen that as heaven is higher than the earth, so is Jesus higher, better, greater than Abel. We have looked at Enoch, and we have seen that Jesus higher, greater, better than Enoch. We have looked at Noah, and we could see that Jesus better, greater, higher than Noah. Tonight, we are looking at the case of Abraham. And Abraham holds a special place in the scriptures, because as you read the Bible, Abraham is called our father in the faith. That places him on a very great pedestal. He was a pioneer on this pathway of faith, and there is every tendency to keep our gaze upon him. But we are admonished to keep looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Abraham, you know, as you read in the scriptures, Abraham was one of the examples that were presented unto us to look, to imitate. Hebrews chapter 6 in verse 12. You see, many times when God wants to pass on a message, he does it in, you know, like a number of ways. He gives you an exhortation. In case you don't understand the exhortation very well, immediately he follows it with an example so that you have an exhortation and you have an example. At other times, he gives you an example, but unless you just read it like a story, he follows it with an exhortation. So those two things are always going together. Example, exhortation. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12, the Bible says that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. It says, don't be slothful. It's an exhortation. But be followers. The word, Hebrew word used there for followers is the word mimetes, that means like imitator. Be an imitator of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. That's an exhortation. But immediately, he follows it with an example. And he says, and when God made promise to Abraham, he says, one of the people to follow is Abraham. You could see through his faith and patience, eventually inherited the promise. 25-year promise eventually came to pass through faith and patience. So verse 12 gives you an example. Verses 13, 14, and 15, I mean, verse 12 gives you an exhortation. Verses 13, 14, and 15 gives you an example of that exhortation. So as you look, Abraham is presented to us as one of those we are to imitate, we are to follow, in their faith. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 7, look at what the scripture says. As we have people that have gone before us, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 7, remember them which have the rule over you. It's talking about remember your leaders, remember your pastors, remember your overseers, remember them which have the rule over you, who has spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith, what do you do?
Follow.
Whose faith follow.
Follow.
Considering the end of their conversation, considering the end of their lifestyle. So whose faith follow? So when we have a father in the faith, his faith we can follow. His faith we can imitate. Somebody like Abraham. So that's important. It says, imitate their faith. Follow their faith. You know where they are going. And yet it says, but look unto Jesus. It's a delicate balance. But we must be able to do the same. Learn from the heroes of faith. Learn from our fathers in the faith. No matter who the person might be, an overseer, whatever name, a big apostle, an evangelist, if they are men, we can learn from their faith. We can imitate their faith. We can follow their faith. But ultimately, we'll look on to Jesus. He's the only one that manifests everything that is perfect. There will always be deficiencies in the faith of the people we follow because they are men. But looking on to Jesus, there is no deficiency. Everything is perfect. And tonight, as we look at the life of Abraham, to learn how to follow his faith, then we go on to the scriptural exhortation, not to look unto Abraham, but to look unto Jesus. So number one, we want to learn from our father in the faith. In Romans chapter 4, see what Abraham is called. And that places him, on the high pedestal of, of our faith. Romans chapter 4, verse 12. He says, and the father of circumcision, it was Abraham that God gave the covenant of circumcision to, and he passed it on, and the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision, but who also walk in the steps of the faith of our father Abraham, which he had been yet uncircumcised. There you are finding, he say, Abraham is our father in the faith. He's a father of circumcision, but he's also our father in the faith. To the Jews, the circumcised is a father of circumcision. To the Gentiles who are uncircumcised, he's a father of faith and is our father in the faith. So Abraham is referred to as our father in the faith. There are many tremendous lessons we can learn from Abraham, from this passage, from Hebrews, mainly from Genesis. And time will fail us tonight because Abraham is a very big figure with a lot of passages in the scriptures. We can't read all, but you are familiar with some of his story. What are the things we can learn from Abraham? Number one, Abraham's positive response to the call of God, even at an old age. Do you realize that God called Abraham when he was 75? That's an age when many people are just settling down and they will tell you the sun is already setting, there is no going anywhere. But God called him at 75. God called him to leave certainty for uncertainty. God called him to leave the known for the unknown. God called him to leave the familiar for the unfamiliar. God called him to leave loved ones and go unto total strangers. To take such a risk at such an old age is highly commendable. But look at who we are on the platform. You are young. If Abraham at 75 can respond to the call of God, I pray that you at 35 will be responding to the call of God.
Amen.
And you are 28 and you are maybe 52, you will respond to the call of God.
Amen.
I think that time has passed, I'm too old. If Abraham at 75 can positively respond to the call of God, to leave the known for the unknown, to leave the familiar for the unfamiliar, to leave certainty for uncertainty, to leave loved ones and to go to total strangers, and he could take that kind of risk at that age, we can do the same. That's one of the things we are learning from the life of Abraham. Number two, look at Genesis chapter 12. As God told Abraham to go to the land he's going to give unto him, did you know that all didn't go well? You know, that's the problem with some people. They say, when I gave my life to Christ, I didn't know it was going to be this hard. I didn't know it was going to be like this. Maybe I would not have been saved. Look at the hardship I'm going through. When God called Abraham, God told him he was going to inherit a blessing. But God didn't say there would be no difficulties. In Genesis chapter 12, look at it from verse 9. Genesis chapter 12, verse 9. And Abraham journeyed going on still toward the south, and there was a famine in the land. And Abraham went down into Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was grievous in the land. God called him to go to the land that is going to give unto him. On getting to the place, the first experience of Abraham was a grievous famine. He didn't abandon that call. The hardship did not make him to abandon the call. He stayed where God wanted him to be. And I pray that whatever difficulties, persecutions, or maybe hardship we meet along the way will not make us to abandon the pathway of righteousness in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our lives to God, we will follow and follow through in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Abraham did not abandon. For you to know, look at Genesis chapter 26, verse 1. In fact, the children of Abraham later, look at what happened. Look at what happened to Isaac. There are no guarantees. As God is calling us and calling our children, what we face, our children may face it. In Genesis chapter 26, I read to you in verse 1. The Bible says, Genesis 26, in verse 1, it says, and there was a famine
in the land.
The land.
Beside the first famine that was in the days of Abraham, and Isaac went unto Abimelech, king of the Philistines, unto Gerar. So this is another generation, another famine. And the Bible says this famine is different from the one that was in the time of Abraham. And yet, this is in the land that God said he was going to give them. Hardship, but they didn't leave the land. Famine, but they didn't run away. They stayed there. I pray that as God has called us, even when things are tough, we are moving ahead.
Amen.
I'm going to tell the devil there is no going back.
Amen.
As on the plow, we are facing the front.
Amen.
We are getting to our destination and to our destiny in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So that's another thing we learn from Abraham, that he did not abandon the call, even when conditions were far from favorable in the land. He stayed there in the land. You know, that's why the Bible says that if they had considered where they are coming from, they would have had opportunity to have returned. That's Hebrews chapter 11. They would have said, where I'm coming from, there was food. Where I'm coming from, loved ones are there. I would not be going through this kind of difficulty. Why am I here? The Bible says, but when they left, they beat the pie and said, we are not coming back. If they had thought about where they're coming from, they would have had opportunity to backslide, to go back. My brother, you have given your life to Christ, face the front. My sister, you have said bye-bye to the world. Let it be a forever bye-bye. Don't think about where you are coming from. Think about the glorious place God is taking you. Face your front and move on, and the Lord himself will do it in your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
What is the third lesson that we can learn from Abraham? God defended Abraham against the oppressors of the land. God will defend you against the oppressors of the land.
Amen.
As you are following his promise, he will stay with you. Amen. That's why the psalmist said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Look at in Genesis chapter 12, when Abraham faced the first oppressor in the land. Genesis chapter 12, and I read Genesis chapter 12, I read from verse 17. And the Bible says, and the Lord plagued Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. The moment Abraham and Sarah got to Egypt, the king of Egypt, he just took Sarah. I'm going to marry this one. She's a man's wife. I'm the king here. I do and undo. All right? You think you are the king, you do and undo. God came and plagued his house, you know, with plagues. If you want to oppress that man, I will show you I am God. And what happened? In verse 18, and Pharaoh called Abraham and said, what is this that thou hast done unto me? Why didst thou tell me that she was thy wife? Why sayest thou she is my sister? So I might have taken her to me to wife. Now, therefore, behold thy wife, take her and go thy way. He said, Abraham, why did you lie to me that she was your wife? Abraham said, well, if I told you she's my wife, she's so beautiful, you would have killed me because you want to marry her anyway, and I want to live. So I said, she's my wife. I mean, she's my sister. Why must your eyes as the king be on every woman that passes in your territory? You already have wives. Oppression. But God came and said, no. If the man cannot defend himself, I can defend him. And Pharaoh knew that this is the finger of God called Abraham. I've never gone through this kind of thing before. It's because of you. Who is this woman? Is she really your sister? Abraham said, well, really not. It's my wife. So why did you tell me? She said, well, you understand? God defended him against oppressors in the land in Genesis chapter 20. And my brother, maybe where you are working, there are oppressors in that company. God will defend you against those oppressors in that company.
Amen. So
maybe my sister, where you are doing your job, there are people that are just oppressors in that place. God will defend you against those oppressors in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Genesis chapter 20. And Abraham journeyed, you know, from thence toward the south country. And if you read chapter 20, it was the case of Abimelech. Abimelech again took Sarah, Abraham's wife, another oppressor in the land. And what did God do? Look at in verse 3. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, behold, thou art but a dead man. For the woman which thou hast taken, for she is a man's wife. You know the story again. Abimelech had to call Abraham and said, but what have you done? What I'm trying to say is that in chapter 12, in Egypt, over here, in the land of the Philistines, God defended Abraham because he was living for him. God will defend you.
Amen.
Against your precious of the land in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Number 4, we can learn from Abraham's patient wait for the fulfillment of God's promise. God told him, I will give you a son. That promise was given when he was 75. In Genesis chapter 21, verse 5, the Bible says, and Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born.
Unto him.
75 years when he had the promise, 100 years when he had the son, 25 years of patient waiting. If I said, I didn't, who would have thought that I would have given Abraham a child? Who would have thought that I would have given birth even in my old age? Sarah even is like almost a hopeless situation, but God fulfilled his promise. But Abraham waited patiently for the fulfillment of God's promise. My sister, Wait for the fulfillment of God's promise. My brother, wait for the fulfillment of God's promise. His promises, they are here and amen. He will never fail you. He has never failed you. In fact, if you read in the scriptures, Joshua said, not one promise, not one word has failed of all that God has promised us, all are come to pass this day. God keeps his word. God keeps his promise. But you need to be steadfast. You need to wait patiently for him. Maybe you are there, you are not married, and it seems as if years are going by. You will be married. God will settle you in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
You are married, and there is no issue. And you are wondering, oh God, I've waited 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. Time is going. The Lord will visit you and fulfill his promise in your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
From Abraham, it's never too late when you are dealing with God. Number five, what do we learn from Abraham? Abraham's prompt obedience when God called upon him to offer his son Isaac as a sacrifice. This is the son that God said through him, I will bless the world. I will bless you. And now God said, take that son and go and sacrifice it. Other people would have said that, God, but you are contradicting yourself. If I kill this boy now and I sacrifice, how are you going to be able to fulfill your promise? But the Bible says that Abraham knew that if God had to resurrect Isaac to fulfill his promise, God never fails. He will. So Abraham just went. Can you see that prompt obedience? God said, take your son, go to Mount Moriah and offer it. And the Bible says, early in the morning, Abraham saddled an ass. He took the wood, he took the fire, he took Isaac and himself and two servants. And they went to the place that God has called him to go and sacrifice. Prompt obedience. My brethren, let our lives be marked by prompt obedience. We normally say we are Abraham's children. Let Abraham's character also be in our life. If you want Abraham's blessing, let Abraham's obedience and consecration be in your life. You know, many people sing the song, Abraham's blessings are mine. And no blessing is coming. And I say, God, you are not fulfilling your word. Abraham's blessing, if it's going to be yours, Abraham's obedience and consecration also must be yours. Because the blessing didn't come out of nothing. The blessing came out of commitment. The blessing came out of consecration. The blessing came because of obedience. If you are willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land. So we see the prompt obedience of Abraham when God called him to sacrifice his son. What else do we learn from the life of Abraham? Abraham's unquestioned obedience in the case of restitution in marriage. Things were not right. Genesis chapter 21. In the life of Abraham at that time, and there was a lot of confusion in the house. Two women in the house, and God had already said, one man, one wife. Not one man and one wife maid, because Sarah was like a maid. Agar was like a maid and a wife. God didn't say one and a half wives. It's only one wife. So eventually, Sarah got tired, and Sarah told Abraham, this lady needs to move. We need to live the way God wants us to live. In Genesis chapter 21, in verse 10, you know, and the Bible says, when Sarah said it, Abraham didn't like what Sarah said. No. In fact, look at in verse 6. And Sarah said, God had made, verse 10, let me read from verse 9. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, which she had born unto Abraham, mocking. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, even with Isaac. What was the reaction of Abraham? Verse 11, and the thing was very grievous to Abraham in Abraham's sight because of his son. He said, well, Ishmael is still my son. Cast out the born woman and her child and her son. They cannot be in this house. It's only one man, one wife. It's not one man and one wife made, another one wife made. Cast her out. And I saw. Now look at verse 12. And God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman. In all that Sarah had said unto thee, hearken unto her, unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And also of the son of the bondwoman will I make a nation, because he is thy seed. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and took bread and a bottle of water and gave it unto Hagar, putting it on her shoulder and the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. You understand? Abraham didn't like what Sarah said, but God came to Abraham and said, what Sarah just said, that's the right thing to do. Rise up and do it. Don't let it be grievous unto you. Don't be angry because of it. And once God says that one, there is no questioning. The following morning, early in the morning, Abraham just did what God wants him to do. Are you like that? Or are you going to still be questioning? So what do you have there? You see Abraham's unquestioning obedience in the case of restitution in marriage. God says, it's enough. All this katakata in this house because of two women is enough. Let that woman go with her son. I will still help her and help her son, but she must not be in this house. Restitution in marriage. And it was not easy for Abraham. But once God told him what Sarah said, that's the right thing to do. He didn't go back to Sarah. He didn't do anything. The following morning, early in the morning, Abraham executed it. I pray that our obedience will be unquestioning obedience. I pray that our obedience will be prompt obedience.
Amen.
And God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Number 7, what else are we learning from Abraham? Abraham's disposition to hospitality and caring for other people in Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18. You know, some people were just passing by. Abraham didn't know them. He thought that they were strangers. He didn't know that they were angels. And Abraham told them, come in, let me cook for you. Let me, you know, refresh you. Let me accommodate you before you go on your journey. Genesis chapter 18, verse 1. And the Lord appeared unto him in the plains of Mamre. And he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day. And he lifted up his eyes and he looked, and lo, three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself toward the ground and said, my Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away, I pray thee, from thy servant. Let a little water, I pray you, be fed and weigh and wash your feet. And wash your feet. Arrest yourselves under the tree. You know, Abraham was caring for them. And then he says, and I will fetch if you don't understand. He cooked. He told Sarah, take that animal they killed, make some cakes, make some dough, they cook food, cook meat. No, I set it before the men and they ate. And Abraham didn't know them. He didn't know they were angels. He just thought they were strangers that were passing by. Let me be hospitable. Hospitality. That's why the Bible says, be not forgetful to entertain strangers. For some have entertained angels unawares. It's referring to Abraham. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 1. And that's what we are learning from Abraham, that we should be hospitable. Brethren, let's be hospitable. Don't worry, I don't even have enough. How can I give strangers my food? God will multiply the food. Be hospitable. The widow of Zarephath, Elijah comes along, be hospitable. This food is not even sufficient to feed my family. Don't worry, God will multiply it. Be hospitable. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels
Honoré.
Abraham didn't know that those men were angels. He just thought they were just ordinary men. He didn't know them before, but he was hospitable to them, you know, cared for them, gave them food, got them rested before they would continue in their journey. And if we are children of Abraham, we need to be like that. We need to be hospitable. When people come to your house, be hospitable. The food you are going to give to them, even when you don't have sufficient in the house, be hospitable. Because God knows he will bless you as a result. So we are learning from Abraham's disposition to hospitality and caring for other people. What else are we learning from Abraham? Abraham's compassion and Abraham's willingness to stand in the gap for others. When he heard that Sodom and Gomorrah, God was going to burn Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he started praying, oh God, if you find 50 people there, will you destroy those 50 with the righteous? God said, no, 45, no, 40, no, 35, no, 30. He stood in the gap for the perishing. He stood in the gap for Sodom and Gomorrah. What a compassion, what a willingness to want to pray, you know, for people that are perishing. And we need to learn that. He's our father in the faith, but you can see the ways in which faith affected his life, how faith impacted his life. And faith ought to impact our lives like this. It's not just to have faith to be able to receive, you know, puff from God. It's more than that. It's more than that. Because that's what some people think that faith is all about. Faith to receive puff, faith to receive chin-chin, faith to receive donut. My brother, is more than that. Faith must impact every area of your life. Faith that makes you to be hospitable even when things are difficult. Faith that makes you to be compassionate and willing. You know, people that are perishing, you can stand in the gap for them. Number nine, Abraham's ability to forgive and to still rise up to rescue the offender when needed. You remember, he was the one that brought Lot to the land. He just wanted to be a blessing to Lot. And as he brought Lot, now there was a friction between his servants and the servants of Lot. And Abraham said, we are brothers. We shouldn't be fighting. Now, the whole land is before us. Lot, make a choice. If you go to the west, I will go to the east. If you go to the south, I will go to the north. Make a choice. And Lot could have said, Uncle, you are the one that brought me here. Without you, I wouldn't have any blessing. How can I be making a choice? Give me whatever you want to give me. And that would have been very, very good humility. But the Bible says, Lot lifted up his eyes and he saw the most, you know, fertile ground. And he chose that. You brought somebody to come and eat puff. And there are 10 in the bowl. And then you tell him, okay, choose. Then he ate 9 and left you one. You understand? Is that the way to do it?
No, sir.
You wouldn't have puff if I didn't invite you. Now, they gave me 10 puff inside the bowl, and I said, choose. Then you ate 9. You left me 1. Is that the way to do it? That's what Lot did. Lot looked at the best, and then he took it. And then Abraham said, don't worry, I'll take the rest. And after Lot left, God said, Abraham, even that place that Lot has taken, everything I've given it unto you. Greed doesn't pay off. It will always backfire. But do you know Abraham forgave him? Do you know Abraham didn't hold it up? When now Lot got into problem in Sodom, it was still Abraham that went to go and fight to rescue him. I pray God will give us that kind of a heart.
Amen.
I pray God will give us that kind of a heart.
Amen.
A heart that can forgive the offender. A hand that can forgive somebody that has really, you know, really trespassed against us. And yet, when the person falls into trouble, we are not rejoicing because he fell into trouble. Yes. We rise up to rescue him out of that problem. Yes. I pray God will give us that kind of a, you know, Abraham's hand in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Number 10, what do we learn from Abraham? Abraham's manifestation of faith was beyond his time and his era. Somebody says, what do I mean? Do you know that even some people in the New Testament era are not manifesting faith like Abraham manifested? Because as they were going, Isaac asked his father and said, "My father, we have been sacrificing before. I've seen you sacrifice before. You laid the wood, you put the fire, you killed the ram, and you put it there, sacrifice. But this one we are going to Mount Moriah is strange to me." And Abraham said, "What do you mean? Here is the wood. Here is the fire. Where is the sacrifice?" Abraham did say, "You are the sacrifice," and then Isaac will run away. Abraham said, "Don't worry. God will provide himself." The sacrifice will surface. What faith? Hebrew says that's how he received Isaac back in the vigor. His faith already enacted resurrection even before death took place. That's what he's saying. Resurrection already taking place even before the death has already happened. He received Isaac back in the vigor. He said, "God will provide himself a lamb." Let me ask you, on Mount Moriah, did God provide himself a lamb?
Yes, sir.
Answer me.
Yes, sir.
Can you see faith in manifestation? God will provide himself a lamb. What a faith. His manifestation of faith was beyond his time, was beyond his era. Abraham lived in a primitive era, but his faith is nothing like primitive. His faith was like 20th century ahead of time. God will provide himself a lamb. And God did provide himself a lamb. And Isaac will say, "You said it, Dad." "Yes, I said it. They call those things which are not as though they are." What a manifestation of faith. That's what the Bible says in Romans chapter 4, when he's talking about Abraham, that he called those things which be not as though they are. There was no lamb, but Abraham said, "God will provide himself a lamb." He's calling the thing that is not as though it is, and it eventually it was. And God said, "Go to that bush, take that lamb, and then sacrifice it. Don't sacrifice the son, your son." God provided himself a lamb. I pray that our faith will be like that.
Amen.
Faith that is forward looking. Faith that can call those things which be not as though they are, and they will be.
Amen.
And it will be so in Jesus' name.
Amen.
What else do we learn from Abraham? Number 11, Abraham's complete trust and reliance on God and the faithfulness of God. You know, God had told Abraham, "I will bless you." God had told Abraham, "I will enrich you." God had told Abraham, "I will bless you and you will be a blessing." But it came to a point when the king of Sodom said, "Abraham, I want to thank you for what you have done. I want to enrich you." Abraham said, "The wealth of Sodom is tainted wealth. I believe what God has said, that he will prosper me and he will make me rich. I don't want your wealth. Keep your wealth to yourself. The people that have gone to fight with me, give them some food to eat so that they can be refreshed. But I've lifted up my eyes unto the God of heaven, that from a pin to a shoe lashet, I will never take anything from you, lest you will say, I have made Abraham rich." Because Abraham is going to be rich, but it's not going to be from you. He trusted God. God has promised he will bless you. When crooked ways of being blessed comes, my brother, reject it. When the devil comes to offer you an alternative, reject it. Rely on God. Trust God like Abraham. God has said he will bless you. Wait for that blessing. Don't let the world be saying, wasn't I that did it? I did it now. Which God? No, 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 no. We want God to get all the glory. Abraham said, "No, I will not touch anything. Even shoe lashes, as small as it is, I will not take. Lest you will say, I made Abraham rich." I want God to get all the glory. Abraham trusted God. You know, when he was interceding for Sodom and Gomorrah, he said, "Will not the judge of the earth do right?" Abraham knew that God is faithful. God will do right. The God of the earth will do right. If he has said something, he will fulfill it. If he has said anything, he doesn't change. He will not disappoint you. The judge of the earth will do right. God keeps his word. So we can see Abraham's, you know, he said, you know, complete trust and reliance on God and on the faithfulness of God. Brethren, let's rely on God. Let's trust him. Let's depend upon his faithfulness. He is faithful that promised, who also will do it. What else do we learn from Abraham? Abraham's gratitude to God for the provision, for preservation, and for mercies that God gave him. Do you realize that Abraham was not a soldier? His servants were cattle rearers, herdsmen. And Abraham took his herdsmen. They went to fight professional soldiers of five kingdoms. And the Bible says they overpowered them. Abraham knew that this is more than military might because we are not soldiers. This is the hand of God. Hand of God giving me the victory that I desire. And when he met Melchizedek, he gave tithes of all because for what God has done, for the victory God has given him. My brother, God has helped you. You didn't die on Mediterranean Sea. He brought you here. My sister, God has blessed you. You didn't get infected when you were in prostitution before you got saved. God preserved you. God has given you work. God is blessing your family. You got married. First child, second child, third child. No deformity, no problem. Everything is okay. Where is your gratitude? God has brought you to a place, you know, of blessing, a place of provision. Where is your gratitude? Abraham was grateful to God because of what God has done. And the Bible says he gave tithes of all. Many believers, they don't pay tithes. And they say, well, I love God. You don't love God. Say, God knows that I love him. There's no gratitude in your life. There's no gratitude for what God is doing. Every day is giving you life. Every day is giving you health. Every day is keeping you safe. Every day is protecting you. Every day he makes provision for you, for your entire family, and the things he's doing for you. And for you to do like Abraham, then you say that you're a child of Abraham. No. If you are the seed of Abraham, you will do what Abraham did. You know, that's what Jesus Christ told the Pharisees. When they say, we are Abraham's children, Jesus said, you. If you are Abraham's children, you will do the works of Abraham. Abraham didn't try to stone the righteous to death. You are trying to stone me to death. You are evil. If you are his children of Abraham, you will do the works of Abraham. If we call ourselves Abraham's seed, then follow the steps of Abraham. Follow the footsteps of the faith of our father Abraham, according to Romans chapter 4, verse 12. Follow the footsteps. The footsteps of Abraham was footsteps of gratitude. Gratitude to God for his provision. Gratitude to God for his preservation. Gratitude to God for victory in warfare. Gratitude to God for the mercies that God gave to him. And he gave tithes to Melchizedek. I'm not reading all these passages because of our time. That's Genesis chapter 14. And you read it there. He gave tithes of all. Number 13, what kind of lesson can we still learn from Abraham? Abraham, you know, we can learn from Abraham's contentment with God's provision. As at the time he met the king of Sodom, maybe Abraham was not very rich. His eyes could have been in the wealth of Sodom, but he was contented with what God gave him. And he said, no, I don't want that wealth. It is polluted wealth. It is defiled wealth. It is tainted wealth. I don't want it. I may not have enough, but this is not for me. He was contented. The Bible says godliness with contentment is a great gain. He was contented with God's provision and his refusal to be defiled by the tainted well of Sodom. My brother, let's be contented. Godliness with contentment is a great gain. Don't let all these flashy things in the world make you to compromise. God has said, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. Therefore, the righteous may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not care what can man do unto me. He will help you. Wait for him. He will provide for you. He will bless you. Don't be tainted with the wealth, with the dirty wealth of the world. Don't be tainted with all these defiled loots of the world. Wait like Abraham. Wait on God. Have contentment with what God has provided you. Number 14, Abraham's total obedience in keeping the covenant of circumcision. God told Abraham, circumcise your son. Circumcise yourself. And circumcise all the males in your house. And Abraham did. He was old. And you know one thing with the old people? When they had a wound, It doesn't heal quick because of the constitution of their body. Abraham could have given that as an excuse. If I sacrifice, if I circumcise myself now, I will not heal quickly. I'm too old. But no excuse. When God told him covenant of circumcision, the Bible says he circumcised himself. He was 99 years old when he circumcised himself. But he did. He didn't say my skin would not heal easily. I'm too old. He did. Complete obedience, total obedience to the word of God. Oh, I like Abraham. If you read the life of Abraham, you know, we're just summarizing. What a great life. That's why when people sing that song, Abraham's blessings are mine. Oh, I'm praying and saying, may Abraham's commitment, obedience, and consecration, may it be yours also.
Amen.
For Abraham's blessing to be yours, Abraham's obedience must be yours. Abraham's consecration must be yours. Abraham's commitment must be yours. Abraham's prompt response to God must be yours. Abraham's, you know, hospitality and care must be yours. Abraham's compassion and willingness to stand in the gap for the perishing, it must be yours as well. That's important. And lastly, Abraham's priority and commitment to worship as he raised up altars unto God. Look at Genesis chapter 12, verse 8. These are 15 lessons that we can learn from Abraham. I've been, you know, rushing over them, but when you get old, all the passages are there. Look through the passages, look at it one by one. You know, Genesis chapter 12, verse 8. And he removed from thence unto a mountain on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the east, on the west, and Ai on the, and Ai on the east. And there he builded an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. This was as soon as Abraham got into the land of Canaan. The first thing he did, priority, was to raise an altar. Let that be a priority also. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added unto you. Let your priority be worship. Let there be commitment to worship. Raise altar unto the Lord. Worshiping, serving. If Abraham is our father in the faith, you can see how faith impacted every area of his life. And I'm praying that the same faith will impact every area of our lives in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. We thank God for the lessons we can learn from Abraham. We're looking at Jesus and looking at Abraham. And here the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Mm-hmm. Although we can learn from Abraham, our father in the faith, our look is to be directed at Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Why is it that we should always look unto Jesus? Mm-hmm. We are learning from Abraham, but we are looking unto Jesus. Number one, Jesus was always steadfast and faithful. We can't say that of Abraham. In moments of pressure, Abraham yielded to temptation. In moments when there is a possible risk to life, because Abraham said, if I tell them you are my wife, they will kill me. He told lies. And the Bible recorded it. He did it in Genesis chapter 12. He did it again in Genesis chapter 20. So in moments of pressure, in moments when there were possible risks to life, Abraham could compromise and tell lies. You see that in the scriptures. But you know what the Bible says? Jesus remained uncompromised and undefiled. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26. That's why you need to look unto Jesus, not unto Abraham, not unto Abraham. Hebrews chapter 7, in verse 26, the Bible says, for such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners and made higher
than the heavens.
That's Jesus. When you read in Hebrews chapter 4, in Hebrews chapter 4, the Bible says Jesus was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. Jesus was talking to some people and he said, which of you convinced me of sin? Nobody could convince him of sin. You know what he said? The priest of this world cometh and finds nothing. That's Jesus. He was steadfast, always steadfast, always faithful, always. We can't say that of Abraham. We can see two instances where, because of pressure, because of fear of men, Abraham told lies. So who should we look on to? Look on to Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Number two, Jesus will not be led astray by the bad counsel of other people, be it Satan or men. You know, when the people have children, I mean, a child, after some time, Sarah began to mount pressure on Abraham. Hey, I also want to carry baby. Hey, it doesn't really matter. At least this girl, she's my mate. If she gives birth to a child, hey, it's my child also. Go in unto her. Let me have a child by her. It was Sarah that put pressure on Abraham. It was Sarah that led Abraham astray by bad counsel. And Abraham agreed, went in unto Sarah. That's how Ishmael was born. Abraham could be led astray by bad counsel, but Jesus could not. Eve could be led astray by bad counsel. Satan came and said, do you know what? God told you not to eat this. I'm telling you, it's sweet. If you eat it, you will be somebody else. It is something else. Bad counsel. And the Bible says that's how Eve listened and sinned and took the fruit that God said he should not eat. She ate and gave to the husband. He also ate. Satan led them astray by bad counsel. But Satan also came to Jesus, turned this stone into food. No. Jumped down, from the pinnacle of the temple, because God will give his angels charge over you. No. Worship me, and I'm going to give you a lot of things. No. Jesus could not be led astray by bad counsel. He refused all that temptation. He refused all that suggestions from Satan and told Satan, get thee behind me, get away. But Abraham fell. That pressure that Sarah mounted, eventually, it made Abraham to give in. Eventually, before you know it, he went into Hagar. That girl conceived. Ishmael was the result. Moment of pressure. That's what happened. Abraham was led astray by the bad counsel of Sarah, who mounted pressure on him. My sister, are you there? Don't mount pressure on your husband. If he's walking the way of righteousness, don't mount pressure on him to do what you want. And at the end of the day, it's going to be to the detriment of the entire family. Ishmael has been a blight on the world up till today, but it was because of pressure mounted until the man yielded. But you can't mount any pressure on Jesus for him to you. No, he could not be compromised. He could not be led astray by bad counsel. But in the case of Abraham, he was. In the case of Eve, he was. In the case of Amnon, he was. Jonadab counseled him how to rape Tamar. And that was what he did. In 2 Samuel chapter 13, many people are led astray by bad counsel. They are not stable in character. But Jesus, you can't lead him astray by bad counsel. Do you see the reason why we are not to look unto Abraham? Because there are frailties, because there are faults, because there are deficiencies. But we can look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Number three, Jesus did always those things that please God. John chapter 8, verse 29. John chapter 8, verse 29. Jesus said, and he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do
always
those things
that pleased him.
We can't say that of Abraham, that he did always those things that pleased him. When Abraham went into Hagar, he didn't please God, because God had told him, I'm going to give you a son. It was a moment of doubt and unbelief. He didn't please God. That's important. So we cannot say that of Abraham. Abraham had moments of challenge. He had moments of moral failure in his life. He sometimes did things that displeased the Lord. If you read in Genesis chapter 21, when Sarah said, you need to do restitution in marriage, this girl that you have been keeping as a second wife, she needs to go. The Bible says Abraham didn't like it. You think that pleased God? Of course not. That's why God came to him and said, Abraham, that counseling of Sarah, that's the right thing to do. Arise and do it. It didn't please God. But Jesus said, I do always those things that please him. Jesus, much more than Abraham. That's the person we have to look unto. Number four, Jesus, the priest after the order of Melchizedek, is greater than Abraham. You know Melchizedek? Melchizedek was the priest of God. He met Abraham, and Abraham gave him tithes. Let's see what the Bible says about Melchizedek in Hebrews chapter 7. Even though Melchizedek was a man, he was not an angel. Some people think he was a man. We don't know who gave birth to him. We don't know where he's coming from. God made it so that we don't know his origin in order to be able to make him like unto the Son of God. But he has an origin. He had a father. He had a mother. Then nobody knew when he died and where he was buried, so that it could be like an everlasting priesthood. But of course, Melchizedek died and he was buried. But we don't know when he died and where he was buried. So we don't know where he's coming from. We don't know where he went. So it's like somebody that is just existing forever. But he's like a figure. But he was a man. In Hebrews chapter 7, from verse 1, let me show you. Hebrews chapter 7. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings
and blessed him,
to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace, without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abided a priest
continually.
Because we don't know when his priesthood ended. We don't know how he died, where he was buried. So it's like the priesthood of Melchizedek has been going on. Who ordained him to be a priest? We don't know. It's like his priesthood has no beginning and has no end. Just so that he can be likened unto the Son of God. But he was a man. He was born by one father and one mother, and he died and he was buried. But God hid his beginning and his end from us so that you can just be like somebody who just exists forever. Now, look at in verse 4. Now consider how great this man was. He was a man. Unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils. And verily, they that are of the sons of Levi, who received the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their own brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descent is not counted from death received tithes of Abraham and blessed him that had
the promise.
Verse 7. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better.
Of the better.
What is saying? Melchizedek was greater than Abraham, and he blessed Abraham. He received tithes from Abraham. He was greater. Now, if you read, the Bible says that Jesus is the priest after the order of Melchizedek. Look at chapter 6, verse 20. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 20. Whether the forerunner is for us, entered, even Jesus, made an high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. If Melchizedek was greater than Abraham, the priest after the order of Melchizedek is greater than Abraham. Jesus, much greater than Abraham. And we need to give him worship. We need to give him praise. Jesus, the priest after the order of Melchizedek, greater than Abraham. Number five, even Abraham rejoiced to see the advent of the Messiah, the Savior of the world. You know, the Jews couldn't understand what Jesus said. John chapter 8. And they said, what are you talking about? John chapter 8, verse 56. John chapter 8, verse 56. Jesus said, says, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old. And hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, Verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was,
I am.
Then they took up stones to cast at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple. You understand here? They said, now we know that you are very crazy. You are not even 50 years old. And then you said that Abraham rejoiced to see your day. From where to where? He said, before Abraham was, I've been from everlasting to everlasting. God said he was going to bless the world through Abraham. But God could not do it physically. I have come to fulfill that promise. And Abraham rejoiced because Jesus is of the lineage of Abraham, and he has come to fulfill the promise that God gave to Abraham, that through Abraham, all the families of the world will be blessed. Through Jesus today, all the families of the world have been blessed. And he said, Abraham rejoiced to see my day. What does that mean? Jesus greater than Abraham. Before Abraham was, I am. Number six, Jesus settled for the perfect will of God. In Hebrews chapter 10, see what Jesus said. Hebrews chapter 10, and we are learning why we should look unto Jesus. He's not just for show. It's a reality. Hebrews chapter 10, I read from verse 5. It says, wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body as thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Then said, I come in the volume of the books. It is written of me to do thy will.
Oh God.
Jesus, he only settled for the perfect will of God, even on the cross. He said, if it be possible, let this cup pass over me, but not as I will, but as thou will. He wanted to fulfill the will of God. And the will of God, that no other alternative. What God wants, that's what he wanted to do. But we can't say that of Abraham. You know, there was a time Abraham told God and said, I'm getting old. You have given me no child. Let me adopt this Eliezer, my servant, so that he will be my heir. God had to tell him that, Abraham, believe me, I'm going to give you a child. Eliezer will not be your heir. At another time, God told Abraham and said, Abraham, do you know what? Sarah, your wife, will give you a baby. Abraham said, oh God, let's put that one aside. Oh, may Ishmael live. At least you've given me one son. Let Ishmael live. You know what? It's like trying to replace, you know, God's perfect will with a carnal alternative. But Jesus said, I come to do your will, oh God. No other alternative. I'm not going to use Eliezer to replace the promised Isaac. I'm not going to use Ishmael to replace the promised Isaac. Let Ishmael live. No. God says, Ishmael may live, but not for me, not to fulfill my promise. It's not a replacement for my promise. It's not going to be, you know, that I'm not, no. And that's important, my brethren. Abraham twice pleaded with God if a carnal alternative could be preserved to replace the divine promise. But for Jesus, that's not. I come to do your will, O God. It must be perfect. What God wants is what God wants. No other alternative. And God is calling us. Look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus. If you look unto Abraham, there are many areas you are going to make a lot of mistakes because the life is flawed. It's a man with frailties, a man with faults, a man with character faults, a man with moral deficiencies. Thank God for grace. Thank God for faith. Thank God is our father in the faith. Thank God we can learn a lot from him. But the Bible says, looking on to Jesus, that's your perfect example. That's the one that never compromised. That's the one that remained undefiled, separate from sinners, higher than the heavens, made separate from sinners. That's the only one. It's the one that nobody can mount any pressure for him to backslide. Nobody can mount any pressure for him to succumb. No devil can counsel him and lead him astray with bad counsel. He does the will of God. I do always. Those things that please him. Abraham never did always those things that please God. There were challenges in his life. There were places where we could see outright failure. He was a man looking unto Jesus. That's why as you compare Jesus with all the heroes of faith, it's you know, if you don't analyze it the way I've been analyzing it, you will be wondering, Jesus and Abraham, Jesus and Abel, Jesus and Noah, Jesus and Enoch, far above any of them. In every form and in every ramification, Jesus, higher, better, greater. That's our perfect example. It's our final sacrifice. It's the savior of the world. It's the founder of our faith. It's the author and finisher of our faith. And I pray that tonight you can learn from Abraham. So many good things you can learn from Abraham. But look on Jesus. As you learn from Abraham, look unto Jesus. As you learn from Abraham, look unto Jesus. As you learn from Abraham, look unto Jesus. I pray that you will look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and tell the Lord tonight, oh God, I'm looking unto the author and finisher of my faith. I thank you for the life of Abraham. I thank you can imitate the faith of Abraham. I thank you I can follow the faith of Abraham. I thank you for Abraham being a pioneer and our father in heaven. I can for me.
I've done the examples of Abraham. I bless your name, O Lord.
I can learn from his total obedience.
Thank you, Lord. I
can learn from hospitality.
Total obedience.
To divine obedience. I can learn.
I can learn from him, O Lord,
and his gifts to be defiled by the world. I can learn,
O Lord,
but ultimately, I'm to go to Jesus, the perfect example. Look unto Jesus, the perfect Savior. Look unto Jesus, the final and full sacrifice. Unto Jesus, the only one that is always steadfast and faithful, the one that never wavered. Looking unto Jesus, the only one that
Jesus
led astray by the bad counsel of others, whether Satan, whether women. Jesus was never led astray by bad counsel. Abraham was. We can look unto Jesus because he always does what was pleasing unto God. We can say that of Abraham. There were times he did what was pleasing to God and God had to correct him. In the case of Jesus, he's a priest after the order of Melchizedek. If Melchizedek was greater than Abraham, Jesus, a priest after the order of Melchizedek, much more greater than Abraham. And if Abraham rejected, you know, I mean, he rejoiced to see the advent of the Messiah because before Abraham was, he said, I am greater than Abraham. Abraham has died awaiting resurrection. Jesus is dead and resurrected. He died, he has resurrected. He's alive again. What a Savior, what a Messiah, what a glory, what a Savior is yours. What a Messiah is yours. Wonderful, wonderful story, wonderful, wonderful fact. Tonight, look unto him. Look
in Jesus' name, to
the only one for the battle of God. God. He said, oh God, I come to do your will, oh God. Not as I will, but as you will. Even though it was painful, it needs to do the will of God. As painful as it was to do the will of God. But Abraham would be negotiating to use a carnal alternative to replace the will of God. Negotiating to use something else to replace God's promise. But not Jesus. Not Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. My brother, look unto Jesus. Back from Abraham. Or look unto Jesus, learn from the obedience of Abraham, or look unto Jesus, learn from the hospitality of Abraham, or look unto Jesus, learn for the endurance of Abraham, not run away from difficulty, or look unto Jesus, learn from, you know, from the compassion and the willingness of Abraham to stand in the gap for others, or look unto Jesus, learn from the manifestation of faith of Abraham, that was beyond his time and era. But look unto Jesus. Learn from Abraham's complete trust. And reliance on God and the faithfulness of God. But look unto Jesus. Learn from Abraham's gratitude to God for mercies bestowed upon him by paying his tithe. But look unto Jesus. Tonight, look unto Jesus. Learn from Abraham. But look unto Jesus. Learn from Abraham. But look unto Jesus. And I pray that as you from Abraham and look unto Jesus, that the thing that is lacking in your faith, God will perfect it in Jesus' name.
Perfect it, amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Father, I just thank you for the insights you are giving unto us, that trying to show us to appreciate our Savior, to appreciate Jesus beyond the present knowledge that we have. Many of us have put Jesus on the level of men, and we have not seen him higher than the heavens, separate from sinners. But tonight, you are showing us that Abraham may be great, Jesus is greater. Amen. Abraham may be good, Jesus is better. Yes. Abraham may be smart, Jesus is smarter. Yes. And you are helping us to see that even though we can learn from Abraham, we can learn from his prompt obedience, we can learn from his unquestioning obedience, we can learn from his total and complete obedience, but we have to look unto Jesus. We can learn from Abraham's hospitality and care for other people, but we have to look unto Jesus. We can learn from Abraham's endurance of hardship in the land of Canaan, not abandoning his call, but we have to look unto Jesus. We can see Abraham's gratitude unto God for divine mercies by paying his tithe, but we are to look unto Jesus. We can learn from Abraham's contentment with divine provision, but we are to look unto Jesus. We can see the way he manifested the faith, calling those things which are not as though they are. God will provide himself a lamp and God did. We also can call those things which are not as though they are, and they will be, but we have to look unto Jesus. Oh Lord, we are praying that whatever is lacking in our faith, as we look up unto you tonight, perfect that which is lacking in our faith in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Faith that is weak, strengthen that faith.
Amen.
Faith that is wavering, oh Lord, make that faith to be steadfast, unmovable in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Bible says we should resist the devil steadfast in the faith. I pray that faith that is vacillating and wavering, oh God, strengthen those kind of faith and make them steadfast in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Faith that is little, oh Lord, boost that faith and make it big. Faith, dynamic faith that will be doing exploits in Jesus' name.
Amen.
As we look up unto you tonight, the author and finisher of our faith, finish what is lacking, perfect that is lacking, add the dimensions that we lack, and make our faith to be the way you want it to be, strong, effective, dynamic, mm-hmm. Faith that is producing exploits in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Faith that so impacts every area of our life.
Amen.
That out of our life, compassion will be oozing out.
Amen.
Obedience will be oozing out.
Amen.
Willingness will be oozing out.
Amen.
Gratitude will be oozing out.
Amen.
Giving will be oozing out.
Amen.
Contentment will be oozing out.
Amen.
Oh Lord, all the qualities we have seen in the life of Abraham as a result of his faith, oh Lord, recreate those things in our lives in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And Lord, I pray that as all these things that are in the life of Abraham are replicated in our life, let the blessings of Abraham also be ours in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And as we look up unto Jesus, because we are living in an era that better blood, better covenant, better mediator, better promises, better tabernacle, according to your word in Hebrews, oh Lord, because of that, our faith should get to a better place than the faith of Abraham, because we have the author and finisher of our faith as our leader, as our model, oh Lord. Perfect our faith in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Every deficiency in our faith, remove in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, because you've answered.
Thank you, Father.
Let your name be glorified.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.